This is my spoiler review for Split, a video which I recommend you only watch. I highly recommend you only watch after you've seen the movie. That's because this is M. Night Shyamalan's greatest twist since The Sixth Sense. That's right, Mr. Twist has finally repeated his first, you know, career-defining twist. It's actually quite impressive. But I have to say that's the best thing about the movie. So you don't want to really know if you should see the movie if you can't experience that twist, but are you still here? Okay, all right, let's talk about it. The big twist is that Split is actually the return of Unbreakable. What? It's the origin story of a new villain for Bruce Willis's David Dunn. In fact, a villain that had appeared in the first drafts of Unbreakable, but was removed, you know, as is the case with, you know, developing a movie. But M. Night Shyamalan filed him away for a rainy day, or actually, I guess, a day when he had some capital to spend, and spend it he has. So at the end of the movie, it turns out that Philadelphia, M. Night Shyamalan's actual hometown. He doesn't like to leave his home to film movies, so they're all filmed in and around Philadelphia. But Philadelphia turns into Gotham. And on the local news, they've dubbed James McAvoy's villain the Horde, which I have mixed feelings on, because it's because he has so many multiple personalities, so together they're the Horde. And while I think it's actually somewhat clever, the Horde is used so often in genre circles that I'm like, you could come up with like a better name. I mean, like even recently, like in the Warcraft movies. But at the same time, the local news isn't, and you know, newspapers aren't known for being particularly creative when coming up with names, right? Like Superman. So it makes sense. They'd be like, oh, let's call him the Horde. That has some like recognition factor built in already because people have heard it. Let's do it. So I kind of like it. I kind of don't. Which is how I feel about this movie. But anyway, and then a patron watching the report says, oh, that reminds me of that guy they put away a few years ago in a wheelchair. What was his name? And then as they push past the woman who just spoke, you see that Bruce Willis's David Dunn is sitting at the end of the counter wearing like a security, he's still a security guard or some kind of, you know, uniform for his work. And it says Dunn on it. And he mutters, Mr. Glass. And then at that point, you have to turn to the people you're going to the movie with, who maybe probably aren't familiar with Unbreakable, because it didn't come out. It came all the way back, 17 years ago at this point in 2000, and say, that's from Unbreakable. And then they're like, what movie? And then you're like, you know, the movie with Samuel L. Jackson with the crazy hair and Bruce Willis. And they go, oh, yeah. Although I have to say, once I explained that to my friends who I went with, they were pretty excited about the whole thing. So I think this really worked. And I think it's a brilliant twist that makes me appreciate Split intellectually, even though I don't find the film itself particularly entertaining. I can't even appreciate Split on its own intellectually, but in the broader scope, I'm mighty impressed. And I'm impressed for three reasons. One, it's the age of the comic book cinematic universe. So if you're going to bring back Unbreakable, this is definitely the time to do it. And I also think that there's room now, as we reach a tipping point of potential oversaturation with, you know, the brightly colored spandex set to some degree. I know they don't wear spandex, but you know what I'm saying. I think that maybe an ultra realistic take on comic book style stories with heroes and villains might be the way to go. Because it's like, oh, you know, you don't have to lose the elements that perhaps you're not, you know, everybody likes a twist on things, right? So you get to keep the fun of the comic book movie stories, but take them in a very different direction. It's a little bit almost like what Nolan did with The Dark Knight, and that nobody has for some reason bothered to repeat since. So why shouldn't M. Night Shyamalan capitalize on that? And also the first Unbreakable, by the way, as I said, it came out in 2000, the year that the first X-Men movie came out. That's kind of interesting with James McAvoy being in both franchises now. But it made in the same ballpark worldwide at the box office as the first X-Men movie did. So, you know, it's not unreasonable to revisit it now that, again, M. Night Shyamalan's doing well. And we'll get to that in just a moment. But the second reason that it impressed me is that they were able to keep this twist a secret. That's amazing in today's day and age. And I think that To some degree, it's because that show, so much Unbreakable, is no longer on the pop culture radar, right? People weren't even coming up with conspiracy theories for an M. Night Shyamalan film, right? I guess that's because he's just starting his comeback. It's arrived now, but still. And also that nobody pays attention if Bruce Willis flies to Philadelphia for a few days, right? Nobody's watching these people. So the question is this surprise return of Unbreakable enough to renew interest in that film and also Bruce Willis as an actor? And then finally, as I said with Capital, this is an amazing way for M. Night Shyamalan to spend the capital that he earned with The Visit, his comeback film in 2015. He didn't waste any time. We're going to talk about Dwayne Johnson and his capital at the end of the video when it comes to a Black Adam movie, standalone movie, because this movie did make me feel differently about that scenario. But also, the other person this has just turned out great for is Jason Blum, who had faith in M. Night Shyamalan, even though M. Night Shyamalan, you know, I think mostly self-financed The Visit, and, you know, but Jason Blum helped produce it. He put it under his banner. M. Night Shyamalan needed the help, and Jason Blum was there. And now his payback is that he's got a comic book movie franchise, potentially. And M. Night Shyamalan has confirmed that he is going to sit down and start writing a new Unbreakable movie with all three characters this very week. Oh, it's so exciting. Now, I hope it's better written than Split, because it's not one of M. Night Shyamalan's best constructed films. And I suspect that's because the entire thing is a misdirect, but still, it should stand on its own. And I think that the setup, though, is spectacular. Very good setup. This idea of a psychiatrist and a young woman both simultaneously trying to outsmart a man with multiple personality disorder. They used DID, you know, the clinical term, but I think multiple personality disorder is easier for the sake of our conversation. But the idea that they're both trying to outsmart this guy with, like, it's almost like they're both trying to outsmart a team in one person, which I think is very cool. And one woman is using psychiatry and the other is using hunting techniques. That's so good. Like, I loved when Betty Buckley was sitting down with the psychiatrist and she's like, "Who am I really speaking to?" The idea that one identity would masquerade as another. Oh, that was really excellent. I thought it was amazing. Who knew that Dennis was an actor? I was like, "You have some pretty good acting ability here, Dennis." I would, you know, except for the fact you can't control your OCD. But although I can relate to that. But I mean, that's amazing. So I liked that quite a bit. But I feel that while the movie overall has a tremendous payoff with that twist in the greater scope of things, I think that as a movie itself, those two stories had no payoff. And I was really frustrated about that. And I think that once again, M. Night Shyamalan demonstrates that when it comes to mysteries and twists, the simpler, the better. Because it's hard. You can easily get lost, I wrote in my notes here, in lofty ideas about human evolution, the psychology of abuse, etc. You know, I thought that all of those things, I think they threw it at the audience to make the movie seem really intellectual, but if you look at the payoff and how things were not carried through, it's not intellectual. It's pseudo-intellectualism, which I've actually accused Nolan of at some points. So, interesting. All right, so anyway, speaking of abuse, I had a real problem with the fact that the villains in the film, both James McAvoy and Casey's uncle, were able to get away with such horrible things due to the silence, inaction, or poor judgment of both, in this case, female characters. It's a little annoying that it's a female thing, but even if these characters had been male, it still would have annoyed me quite a bit. And I realize that these things do happen. I do realize that people are unable to speak up and defend themselves. I realize that people sometimes are frozen in inaction, and that people have poor judgment. I mean, this psychiatrist reminded me of the psychiatrist, the infamous psychiatrist in the Colorado movie shooting case. A movie theater shooting case. But I think for this to happen with so many characters in the same situation, coming from different angles at the story, just made it seem unbelievable. A little too convenient, and that's poor writing. And also so much for women being the smartest of the species, right? Why put that line in the movie? Why have Casey's father say that if neither character outsmarted the villain? I mean, I guess because she wrote down, say, his name, but what was the likelihood that she would have come across that note on the desk? It was too convenient. I also didn't like the two other girls in the movie were portrayed as disposable. And I realized that was done so that James McAvoy's character didn't come across as too repulsive to the audience. I think it's the same reason he didn't kill their father. But these girls were very nice, and I think it's not a good idea, you know, if someone's going to be a villain and they're going to kill, I think you have to have that emotional, it's got to hit. You know, it shouldn't be like, well, they kind of are lunch, you know? That really bothered me. I mean, they did, I mean, Claire did invite Casey to her birthday party. I mean, they weren't like the sweet, they were like Mother Teresa, but I think they were certainly, they didn't deserve what happened to them. And they included her in all their escape plan efforts, even after she was like, I'm not participating in your dumb plan. They still be like, come on, Casey. And they, I mean, they've tried very hard to include her. And I think you could say it was self-preservation, but it didn't come across that way. And I think the film would have been more effective if all, in setting up him as a villain, James McAvoy, if all three of the women had been killed, or if Casey did end up outsmarting him in the end. So anyway, the performances are amazing. The performances were really, really good. And I think this is probably James McAvoy's best work. It's probably the best role he's ever gotten in terms of being able to show what he's capable of as an actor. And he used the opportunity quite well. He didn't waste it. And I think that, you know, at first I was like, oh, he's kind of broad strokes here. But then you realize that if he's going to portray 24 different personalities, you know, you have to do it in broad strokes so that the audience can clearly tell when you're making a switch. And to his credit, he never crossed over into caricaturism and, you know, to being a caricature, which I appreciated. I also really kind of became attached to his different personalities. Like, for instance, Barry. If I never got, you know, and we only saw Barry in the videotapes, you know, the journal entries at the end. But he seemed really great. Like, if I never got to meet Barry or see Barry again, I would actually feel something of a loss. And I liked even the shot at the end of all their different toothbrushes. They all had their own toothbrushes. It kind of conveyed like a sense of community. And I really liked that. I thought that was really good. Maybe if they have, you know, if the sequel gets greenlit and they are able to move forward as planned, I would love to go to that room where they're all sitting on chairs. I think that would be great. I'd love to see that. Get a little bit of a better budget. Oh, you don't even need a big budget for that, though. I would love it. I also thought that Anna Taylor-Joy has a great face for film, particularly horror, with those really dark, big, expressive eyes. It's a little bit like Big Eyes, you know, that artwork. And I think her acting is good, too. I mean, it's not as good as like James McAvoy's, but it wasn't the same kind of role either. But that little Izzy Coffey as the young Casey was adorable and also a very good actress. Because she, when she pointed that shotgun at her uncle, I believed that moment. That was really good. She sold it. That was really, really impressive. I loved it. Although, again, no payoff with the shotgun when she, as a teenager, pointed it at James McAvoy. And it's like, so sloppy, M. Night. Like, you gotta dot your I's and cross your T's when it comes to screenwriting. You know, how do you put something in there with the shotgun and an adversary and she was unable to pull the trigger and then have that come up again? And she was able to pull the trigger, but there was no, you know, it didn't hurt him. There was nothing, they didn't emphasize it as growth for the character. So that was very frustrating to me. So ultimately, 10 Cloverfield Lane is a much better genre abduction movie. It's very good. But I'm impressed here with how M. Night Shyamalan was able to backdoor Unbreakable 2, and I'm very excited about that movie. I'm very excited about it, in fact. I think that's just fantastic. And the last thing I want to touch on is Black Adam. I tweeted this out last night, and then when I first heard about doing a Black Adam movie separate from a Shazam movie and doing a Black Adam movie first, I know some of you said, oh, well, they never said it first, but the whole point is that, you know, Dwayne Johnson doesn't want to wait anymore, so they're going to do his movie first. And I said that was really stupid. But having seen this movie and how effective it was, I think that creatively it could work. It could work to introduce Black Adam and then at the end introduce Billy Batson, or at least tease that next chapter. That could work. Capital-wise, though, I don't know if it can work. I think that Dwayne Johnson spent his San Andreas capital on a bunch of films that are very similar to the films that he was making before San Andreas that only did moderately at the box office. So I don't know if he's going to be in the same shape as he is right now as a commodity by the time the Black Adam movie comes out. I think that Baywatch, I think that Jumanji, I think that this Rampage movie, etc., I think this could all chip away at his star power that he has right now, and he might go back to being the Dwayne Johnson that he was pre-San Andreas by the time the DCEU gets him, and then you might have just like the DCEU's version of Hercules, and that would be horrible. That would be just so bad. I don't know if the DCEU could take another hit like that. All right, so anyway, that's my thoughts on Split. I'd be so curious to hear your thoughts down below, and you can check out some other videos right now.